Have a looming deadline for a major research project? Whether you're an undergrad writing your first paper or an established author with multiple publications, navigating the research ecosystem can be daunting. That's why the libraries at Columbia University have created From Books to Bytes, Navigating the Research Ecosystem, a set of online resources that define the research cycle, provide you with practical strategies, and guide you through the vast resources available to you at Columbia. The stages of the research cycle recommend that you plan, explore, manage, draft, preserve, and share your work. These stages are not necessarily linear, but they are all connected and all necessary to produce your best research work. Recognize bias. The concept of bias was introduced in 1971 by psychologists as a series of cognitive shortcuts that make assessments of likelihood quick and easy, but prone to systematic error. In simple terms, bias is a mental shortcut. Bias is an inherently human characteristic. Its presence in our research and the research we rely upon can skew findings and impede the development of new knowledge. There are many types of bias, but when we talk about bias in research, we usually mean bias in where we search for information, bias in our research strategy, and bias in the data we use. Where we search for information has an outsized impact on the entire research cycle. We're all familiar with Google, but if we Google tobacco use among college students, we get more than 85 million results. That's a lot to go through. And really, how often do you actually scroll past the first page? The order of Google search results are determined by a ranking algorithm, code written by human programmers. Google's algorithms use not only your keywords, but also your search history, purchase history, and personal contacts to determine the order of your search results. Google results are personalized for you, not your topic. This is useful if you're looking for directions or want a new restaurant to try, but relying exclusively on Google or any single search interface for academic research will lead to skewed results, limiting your ability to justify why this source is the best choice to answer your research question. So, how can we compensate? Perform your search in multiple locations, such as the Columbia Libraries catalog Clio, and at least one or two other databases, such as JSTOR or ProQuest, or even perhaps Google Scholar, recognizing that each of these tools searches a sometimes overlapping but not identical set of sources. Compare the results you find. Be sure to look for information about the reputation of an article's authors and journal with a separate set of searches. Additionally, don't limit your searching to just one session. Schedule time to research your topic over several days, weeks, or months. See how your understanding of the topic changes and keep your results organized. The more you do this, the easier it will become. From engineering to history to dance, every field has developed its own approach to research design, so talk to your professors and follow the best practices in your field. Reflect for a moment. Have you ever used a statistic to introduce your research topic? While data and statistics are useful tools, a common myth about research data is that it is immune from bias because research data is created using numbers. However, these numbers and statistics were gathered and organized by people, all of whom have their own biases. Always ask yourself, who compiled the data? Are they considered a voice of authority in this field? When was this data set gathered? Where was the data gathered? How was this data compiled? And finally, what does the data set measure? Like all research, data reflect the values and interests of their creators. When selecting a data set, pay attention to the affiliations and reputations of authors and financial sponsors. Rely on data from authoritative sources. This can include established government agencies like the United States Census Bureau or well-known organizations like the United Nations or World Bank. Whenever possible, use data gathered on a regular basis instead of a one-time survey. Data gathered frequently are more useful for illustrating trends. Was this a national, international, or local survey? The data's relevance will be determined by the scope and breadth of the population being surveyed. Read the methodology and glossary sections of a dataset to decipher how the researchers compiled their data and how it's intended to be read. What questions didn't they ask? Was anything left out that you feel is important? Look for additional datasets or alternative sources to fill in the gaps. This can vary greatly, from statistics about people and communities around the world to scientific lab results, so avoid selective bias that cites data out of context. When using data you've found elsewhere, be thoughtful about how you gather, inspect, and represent that data. Otherwise, you might misrepresent someone else's research. If you aren't sure how to use a dataset, ask. Research data services in the Columbia University libraries can help you decipher a dataset and determine the best approach to data for your own research. Because bias is an inherently human characteristic, it's impossible to erase its presence entirely from our research and the research we rely upon. As researchers, we have an obligation to ourselves and our communities to address when bias, both implicit and explicit, finds its way into our research. We hope this video has offered some insight into the research cycle and how to best recognize bias. We encourage you to familiarize yourself with the other videos and resources in the From Books to Bytes series, as they all delve deeper into the resources available to you at the Columbia University libraries. And remember, you can always consult with your subject librarian and visit our Ask a Librarian service on the Columbia Libraries website.